Thanks very much for giving me the opportunity to bother you with some economics and slightly change the format of the slides. Since it's Christmas, I hope you don't get upset. Take it as a present. What I will be talking is about paradigm shifts in economics. And as I will show you in a minute, since I had a very strict constraint on the time limits I could use to analyze this kind of shifts, I will only analyze one, which is evolutionary economics. And I will leave the other one out, but as I will show you, this is how I see it. I mean, it's a process of change that we have between. I mean, paradigms are not once and for all. There is a change, and especially in the social sciences, although there are some caveats. sorry. Before starting, I think we probably need to pay a little, 30 seconds of a tribute to the one that, I mean, forces us to be here. And Thomas Kuhn is the one who was actually in 1962 talking about the structure of a scientific revolution. Takes for granted, since this is the fourth or the fifth of this, but just three lines I want you to read. These are the lines. This is probably the most famous definition of scientific paradigm that we have from Thomas Kuhn. Although I need to warn you because a researcher, Margaret Masterman. After 2 years from the publication, after reading the book, she found out at least 20 different definitions. So paradigm maybe is a very successful concept because it can be used in very different ways. The second element, which is important in this definition, is the community of practitioners. Community of practitioners means scholars who are producing the science that is within and is the paradigm. But the community of practitioners is also students. It's also made by students. So students, they learn paradigms. Here at university, you students, I mean, whatever is your subject, you are learning a paradigm. And so even today, you're not learning about a paradigm. You are learning a paradigm. Because paradigm is a way of teaching things, is a way of learning things. So this, to me, is crucial and is one of the main elements. I think it's good to be here with students and scholars. But OK, this is all we can say about teams. So come back. As I said, evolutionary economics is the one I will bring to you to discuss a bit. But is a flow, especially as far as social sciences is concerned. And before talking about evolutionary economics, we need to go slightly back in time. I'm sorry, but I will take only 1 minute. And we have to go before evolutionary. And when there was another shift, well, this is another major shift. This is probably the most important paradigm shift, but is at the end, mid-end 19th century, so it's outside of our scope. But just to understand why is important evolutionary theory, we need to just say a couple of things about what was going on at that time. At that time, the most important economist was Alfred Marshall. Alfred Marshall was the economist, with capital A. And he wrote a book. He was almost forced to write a book, this book, because he didn't want to write it, in 1890. And he was actually laying out the foundation of what we now, the economics that probably, if there are students of economics here, the economics you are taught is there. It's only Marshall, economists say. What is in Marshall? Well, at least as far as, for the sake of our argument, as far as we are concerned today, these are the elements that we are interested in. One is that he imported all the tools of mathematics. So if you have problems with mathematics, it's fault, not the fault of your professor. And he was actually using the Ceteris Paribus clause. The Ceteris Paribus clause is important because it allows you to take a piece of a big problem outside, analyze it, just watching at what we call the first order relationships, leaving outside the second and maybe the third order. There is a general equilibrium which takes everything, but He was just actually saying that you can analyze a very complicated problem by bringing pieces and analyzing these pieces outside of the whole system. And then, obviously, he was introducing the notions of equilibrium, because it's a notion that he took from mathematics, and the notion of elasticity. So this is what Marshall did. Another important thing he did, for the sake of our argument, obviously, he was actually proposing what is called a linear model. The linear model is a complicated model, a clock. A clock is a complicated model. Why? Because it's very difficult to understand. But you can understand in principle. I mean, if you just turn a wheel half a turn, you can understand what's going on at the end to the end of this object, whatever it is. So it's a linear model. And when you have some nonlinearities, usually, I mean, there are nonlinearities that helps adjustments toward the equilibrium. So they're smoother. So you might have something, an overshoot in the system, overshoots this, and then you have that the feedbacks are smoother of this. Just to give you an example, this is a linear model of economy. And you can take, you can analyze this. And any element is connected to the other with well-established causal linkages. But if you want, you can just take out, for instance, you can tap the wheel, and you can call it production function. And you might analyze that as a production function that try to understand what's the effort of the workers in relationship to the output. And then you can just plug it to back again to see what are the relationship with the rest of the you have also, I mean, if you want, you can download. I mean, there's the link. You have saving, and you can take everything out, and you can analyze. This is quite important. And this is all, obviously. But more or less in the same period, after some years, in particular in 1911, an Austrian economist, Joseph Schumpeter, who is this guy, was writing the theory of economic development. In 1911, it was only in German. And he didn't have lots of fame because, for instance, the first translation of his work was 1936. So quarter of a century after that. And what was he saying? He was saying something like that. He was saying, well, look, the idea of competition that we have in an economic system is something that is unreal. If someone of you have been studying economics, first year economics, what they will tell you is that perfect competition is the model. Perfect competition means that lots of firms, they are just competing to sell you homogeneous goods for which the consumers are indifferent. That is, they are orange jumper, more or less. They're not really the same, but they're not very different. And in producing this, they are forced, because of the market, to sell them to the cheapest price possible to the consumers. And in so doing, we have two results. Consumers get cheap orange jumpers, and they are produced with the maximum of efficiency because you have to sell them at a very low price. But Schumpeter says, well, he was scratching his head and saying, is this what we observe in reality? Are we all dressed with orange jumpers? No, we are not. We are all different. Why? Because the problem in real life is that competition does not work in that way. First, they don't want to produce the same jumper that I produced, that the Leoncini firm has produced. They want to produce a different one. So differences in what you sell. I mean, if I can observe you, no one is dressed like another one. You are not dressed like, you do not even have one piece of garment like your neighbor. Okay? So this is a bit of a problem. And this competition, it doesn't work in this way. Why? Because competition works because there are entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs are people who have a vision. And then they are fundamental because they break, they exist in equilibrium. They say, okay, you have all orange jumpers. Oh, here is a blue one. Who wants a blue one? Well, maybe someone will like to have a different jumper. So even if you have an equilibrium, this entrepreneur will break it by just saying, okay, I've got something different for you. Maybe you will like it because you are all dressed the same. And this entrepreneur, how does he do to break this equilibrium? By bringing innovation to the market. So innovation is not only technological. I mean, I am a student of technological innovation, technological innovation, but innovation according to Schumpeter is not only that. I mean, it's also organizational innovation. You can have the same machine, but you can organize the production in different ways, and you can be more efficient than the others. Just think to car producers. USA and European car producers, well, Japanese producers, they have the same plants, more or less. But at a certain moment, they organize the production in a completely different way. Toyotism, with the same kind of technology. So how does that work? The entrepreneur has a new idea. He forces the system to accept this because he's a leader, and it breaks down. The exploitation of this innovation gives him, her, a monopoly power, and the monopoly profits. So why you are incentivated to bring the innovation to the market? Because you wipe out all your competitors and you are the only one left, and so you are a monopolist. But in so doing, this is a disequilibrium. All the system goes in disequilibrium because you are just wiping out all the people. And in so doing, firms are getting out of the market and you are establishing yourself on the market. So there is a disequilibrium. What is a disequilibrium? Disequilibrium is, according to Schumpeter, the normal state of an economy. It's not equilibrium. So this is something. How does it work? I mean, the fundamental dynamics is the innovators, and this is the most famous oxymoron by Schumpeter, is creative destruction. Why? Because I destroy all what was there before, but I create something new because I give you my innovation. So this creative destruction is the first mover. But then, obviously, you cannot leave this guy alone. Imitators will just follow. And in following, they just imitate what he's doing, and then they will reduce his rent, his monopoly profit, if you want, or call it the way you want. And then the system will just gradually wind down towards the equilibrium. But then another innovation comes. Another innovator comes, and then another jump. So he was saying that this is lopsided kind of dynamics. The system goes like this, by jumping from different states. And eventually you can reach the equilibrium, but only for just as a particular case. And this is, probably you have already read this. This is a statement from the theory of economic development. The problem is that is usually being visualized is how capitalism administers an existing structure that is equilibrium. But he says, but this is wrong, because the relevant problem is how it creates and destroys them. This is what is important, not the equilibrium. So this, these are the main points of the Schumpeterian economics. Why I'm talking this? Because now you will see that when we talk about evolutionary economics, well, Schumpeter is useful. So these two guys, they're called, Richard Nelson and Sidney Winter, they published a book in 1982, An Evolutionary Theory of Economic Change. Actually, it was a sort of recollection of the work that was going on since at least 15 years. But that was a really landmark, because they were just putting the idea that an evolutionary theory can be done. But how can you do an evolutionary theory? Well, what they say here is illuminating, and it explains you, because I was actually wasting 5 minutes of my precious time to talk about Schumpeter. Because they say, we are the term neo-Schumpeterians, for us, is the same as saying evolutionary, but even more. We are evolutionary because we want to be Schumpeterian. In order to be Schumpeterian, you need to be evolutionary. Now, there is a long debate on if Schumpeter was actually evolutionary, but this is something we are not interested in now. And so, what is the main point? What are the main characteristics of this new approach? Well, that is simple. It can be said in a simple statement. They just want to remove the mechanical analogy that Alfred Marshall was just not only him, obviously, but he is the main, as the main representative, was putting into economics, and they want to substitute with the biological analogy. Darwin, okay. How do you do that? Well, the evolutionary theory can be explained in four slides, so I will be trying to make the best I can. The first one, for those you know it a little bit, I mean, have you ever come across Darwinian economics, or Darwinian, sorry, selection? This is the main problem, selection. Now, when you translate selection from Darwinian, well, from let's say natural science to economics, you have to find out what is the selection mechanism. The selection mechanism, well, it's easy, it's the market. The market selects firms that are doing well, selects positively, and selects adversely things that are not doing well. That's easy. Now, the market determines opportunities, constraints for firms to go on, but this, if we look at it from this point of view, everything changes. Why? Because a market made of all equal firms is inconceivable. Because if the market selects firm, if all the markets are the same, they are, I mean, suppose here that we are all as tall as 170, okay? And if the selection mechanism says that we will cut the head of any, I mean, that would be, you know, someone cutting the head at 160, we are all dead. So we are extinct. There's no evolution. If this, I mean, cuts at 180, no one will suffer the selection process. So the population is not, even in this case, it's not evolved. It's the same as was before. So if we have all, if a population is made of all the same agents, there's no selection, because the selection can cause all extinctions or nothing. You are not selecting the best one. They're all the same. So this is actually going against the idea of neoclassical, let's say, representative agents, okay? Then, for this reason, you need to have variety. How do you have variety? So if we are different heads, if there is someone that is cutting heads at 170, some will survive, some will die. And this is the selection process and the evolution, because the more the fittest will survive, and who is not fit will die. So generally, I know there are lots of, at FRIAS especially, you have lots of natural science, so I do not pretend to tell you about Darwin's, but mutation, you have random changes to have variety. Now, how do you generate variety? Well, within a firm, you have at least two elements that can generate variety. One is technology. You are different. I mean, I can adopt a different technology. So technology is one of the many elements. That's why the evolutionary theory has started from the analysis of innovation. That's why I'm working on that. Then you have organizational also. And then we'll see about institutions. So within this also, historical condition matters, because if you have success, you might, within a firm, it might be, well, the likelihood of having more success is higher than in other firms. Well, the third element of the Darwinian, of the evolutionary theory, is inheritance. Well, of course, you need to pass to your offsprings your characteristics, the characteristics that are important for your selection being selected positively by Mark. What is the gene that is transmitted? Well, firms, they do not behave in a way that neoclassical tell us. Well, sorry, I mean, if there are neoclassical, it is, but I have to force a bit my arguments. But firms, they do behave in a different way. They do not maximize but they find to try something that is good enough. This is called routine. When you find a sort of protocol that is good enough, and you say, okay, when this happens, go to page 23 and then do the list of what, I mean, do this list. When these are the things is happening, go on page 35 and do this list. So you have protocols that you can use it. They are inheritable, because if there are protocols that are written, I can just give to my offsprings. They can survive within the firms, within the organization. And so they are heritable and they are selectable. Why? Because if I have different routines from yours and you're selected, your routines are probably better than mine. And so yours will go on and mine will die. So this is another element. But, and this is another important one, is, well, unfortunately, evolution from a Darwinian point of view is slow. It takes ages to go on. So if we are waiting for a firm to produce a mutation, we might stay here for ages, and this is not what we are saying outside. But what is the difference with the evolution in the natural context? That here, the Lamarckian one, the adaptation, can work because the routine can be changed. And still is inevitable, can be changed on purpose. And still you can transmit in time. So there is this Lamarckian element that speeds up a little bit the process. So this is good also. And then, you have something different from, obviously, from what is, evolution is random. So you don't know. I mean, evolution produces monster. A mutation is a monster. If the monster happens to be fit, then it becomes normal because it survives. But evolution is made of lots of monsters that simply die because they're monster. They're not apt. They're not fit for survival. And so it's random. We do not want that our economic system goes on at random. So someone must decide on which way is better. And so institutions are a way to. Institutions are important. Why? Because they are just setting up the strategic direction. Where do we want to go? Where should Germany go in the next 20 years? Someone must tell us. Shall we go in information technologies? Shall we produce cars? Shall we produce jumpers? Okay, so these institutions, they actually are supporting, influencing, molding, determining the direction and the rate of technological learning, if you want. One example, I do not have time to go on, but if you're interested, we can discuss, is the concept of the national system of innovation. It was actually brought about by a prominent evolutionary theorist, a prominent economist, Chris Freeman, to explain why Japan has done that. Japan is the only developing countries who did that, to catch up with the developed countries. How did they do? They didn't do in the proper way. That is, they didn't do within the neoclassical framework. How did they do? And Chris Freeman was successful in explaining that they did it in another way, their own way, with the national system of innovation. We can tell later on. So, some propositions. Population and not individual are the unit of analysis. So, first of all, the unit of analysis, if you go to a representative agent, this is a simple one of the units that can do that. But the simple unit cannot influence, unless it's that big, cannot influence the direction of the development of this. So the first thing, you can explain how single agents behave, and you can also explain populations. Well, neoclassicals cannot do that. Then you have the satisficing is rather than optimizing. Maximizing behavior is what usually is assumed. There are lots of mainstream economics has taken on board this idea that usually agents are not rational. So the concept of a bounded rationality has been taken on board. So lots of these concepts from satisficing kind of literature has been taken on board by neoclassical, because optimizing is one of the many cases under the heading of satisficing behavior. The third element is important is that evolutionary is dynamic by itself. So it's about a dynamic efficiency rather than a static. So it's about the development of a system. And how do you develop the system? For instance, technology is the best way to develop it. Within a neoclassical, if you take straight neoclassical, of course, I'm playing around with it, but if you take the straight model of perfect competition, there's not enough resources to make an innovation in the mainstream idea. Because you do not have profits. You do not have money to make investments in these kind of things. The last one is that, obviously, equilibria can happen, but there are a particular case of a bigger kind of template that you have with disequilibrium. So these are the main proposition for which I claim that this might be a paradigm. Now, I'll close, I have 3 minutes, because Right in that period when I was starting, right, when Alfred Marshall was writing and when Schumpeter were writing their books, someone wrote this nice statement. Someone who had already understood everything. Very clever, very smart guy. Because he was saying, the mecca, I mean, you can read by yourself, the mecca of economics is in biology. So he had, this guy had already understood everything. So he, and he was going on, actually. This is an except, I mean, from what he wrote. And he says, well, I will make a brief, I mean, a summary of what is written. You can read by yourself. He was saying, well, the analytical biology would be nice, but we do not have the tools. It's very difficult to implement. And so far, we do not know how to do. It's too much difficult. How do you deal with this equilibrium in 1920? You don't have the math. You don't know how to do that. So he was saying, well, so since I am writing a book on foundations, well, I will use something that is, of course, limited, but this is the only way I know how to do that. Who was this smart guy? And so we are back to the beginning again, because it was Alfred Marshall. After some time, he was doing the, well, he did lots of editions of his Principles of Economics, and in the preface was just saying, well, yeah, you have to understand that this is a rough approximation of what would be, because what would be, what will be, is in another kind of domain. So, well, I put this because I want, there was a perfect circle going on, so my idea of symmetry has been in a way satisfied. And I'm finished here, 1 minute before the end. And before finishing, I need to make an advert, because this is the next FRIAS lecture on paradigm shifts in economics. That's it.